Welcome back to Let's Code. I'm Chris Biscardi, and today we're going to go over this little demo right here. Now, I saw a GIF of basically this on Twitter a while ago. I can't find the tweet it was referring to, unfortunately, or it would be showing it right now. But the basic concept is some geometry drops in, it lands on some pillar or something like that. It connects the line between the new cube and the existing pillar, basically doesn't exist. And then it just loops over and over and over. And you can see up in the top hand, the top left, we basically have one cube coming in and then going out and then despawning. And then a new one comes in over the top and goes out and despawns. So I was really curious to see if I could replicate the effect. This is a very simple version of the effect. So it is basically five cubes in total, four of which make up the bottom pillar, and one of which is animated through. If we go into Bevy Inspector eGUI right here, and I start changing these scale values. So if I bring the scale up to 3, you can see what's actually happening in this loop. We have the cube spawning in on the top, then it goes down to the bottom, and once it gets to the bottom, it despawns. And we just sort of get lucky here that the colors that we're using and the positions of the cubes and things like that all end up melding together. That was one of the biggest questions I had when I set this up in the first place, whether these cubes would actually be able to stack with no seams between them. So we can keep that running in the corner as we talk about this. This is one of the, I think, simpler examples of a shader that we've used so far, which is really exciting. So I've chosen to organize the code quite a bit in this example. So we've got a main.rs for our binary crate and a lib.rs for our library crate. The lib.rs specifies two modules, cube and materials, which are both exported. So in main.rs, you can see that we have rotating column, which is the name of the crate that we are currently in. So thus becomes the name of the library. And we pull in cube and a couple items from cube and materials and a couple items from materials. We are using Bevy Inspector eGUI for that little debug panel that we showed earlier. And really interestingly, Bevy Tweening. Bevy Tweening specifically is what gets us the animation loop here. So what's happening is we have one tween responsible for the rotation of the initial drop. We have another tween that's responsible for the drop itself. And then we have a third tween that's responsible for pulling the cube out. And the first two run in parallel and the second one runs after those. Or the third one runs after those. So let's start in main.rs and get some of the scaffolding out of the way. We set a clear color to set the background to this light blue. We set up the watch for changes for the asset server settings. This lets us change our shader at any given time to change these colors, and it will just automatically hot reload, if you're familiar with that term, or update without having to restart the application. We've got the default plugins as usual so that we can create windows and things. We've got the tweening plugin, which comes from Bevy Tweening, which we'll talk about later when we talk about the cube. The shader utils plugin is, again, my custom shader utilities that I just happen to include in all of these, but we don't actually use it here. Then we've got the cube material plugin, which is a custom plugin for the shader material here in the material file. A setup system, the inspector plugin, which spawns that, you know, inspector plugin, and then this cube completed system. The setup for the scene sets a set of 4 cubes. So the ones on the bottom here that you can see that the top cube is falling onto is a set of 4 cubes stacked vertically. In this case, the cube size is 0.2 instead of 1. We create a mesh that is the new cube size. I paint the vertex colors on because I use that for debugging purposes. But if you were, say, not interested in seeing the colors for each of the vertexes from your shader, you could delete this code. We add the mesh to the assets database for the meshes. And we set the number of squares that we want to have in our animation here. So this is just the number for this first column of squares. We have our own custom cube material that takes a color that we don't use actually. And then we spawn in a material mesh bundle with the mesh handle, our custom material, and the position that the cube needs to be to stack. So in this case, we've got 4 cubes. So we do 4 Y position in 0 dot dot num squares. This is called a range. If you haven't seen this before, it allows us to go 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 up until whatever number this is. Then we take that index and we multiply the cube size by y, so we get the distance that the number of stacked cubes before this has on the screen. And then we subtract the number of squares times the cube size. We subtract this number because we're trying to, or rather I've set up this example so that this spot that this top cube lands on is 0, 0, because that's the point I want to focus on for the GIF loop. And it just makes it easier for me to set up the camera and think about like, where am I trying to get a view on, rather than making the view like plus N squares or something like that. So that's the reason that we subtract, so that all of these are below 0, 0, and this point right here that the cube lands on is 0, 0. Then we've got a custom command here to spawn in the cubes. This does basically the same thing that we were just looking at, but we'll go over it in a second. So this spawn cube is responsible for the cube that drops in with the rotations and the tweens and then leaves. Then we spawn in our camera 3D bundle. We've chosen to go with an orthographic projection here, which you can see because the angles of these like cube sides didn't change when we changed the scale of the scene. So I also don't understand how all of these settings interact yet. So I've set the scale to like 1/1000th or whatever that is. One day, maybe I will be able to set this up without having to do some absurdly low number like that. And then we've got our cube completed system. So this system interacts with the tweens. So I think we'll go over it when we do that. What basically happens here is that when we're allowed to set labels on each of the tweens or events, right? So whenever the tweens that we care about end, so one of them ends when this cube stops on top of the column, and the other one ends when the cube finishes its third tween down to the bottom of the column. So when this cube stops, this whole animation takes 2 seconds. We want to spawn in a new cube so that as this one is falling, the next one is falling in. And it looks like it's only almost going to hit this cube as it goes out, but not quite. So we use the same spawn cube command because we're not making any changes. It's the same thing over and over. And then because we don't want all of the cubes that go off screen to just stick around forever, we despawn those. So we'll see this tween events enum in a little bit. The most interesting thing here is that we've taken this tween events because we get to pass some user data along with the tween, but the user data is a U64, so we can only pass integers. So this tween events can go back and forth from an enum to a U64 and back using the try from implementation. So we've basically set up this column of cubes, and we have this cube rotating in with some tweens and also despawning when it's done. The cube material plugin is responsible for selecting colors for the top, the left, and the right sides. And if you slow this down a little bit, you can see actually that the color as this cube rotates between the left side and the right side here is a mix between the two of them. So what we end up with is actually as this side rotates to the other side, so as it turns 90 degrees, it changes from fully the color on the left to fully the color on the right using a mix function. So of course we use the new high level impl material trait for our cube material. Our cube material is just a color, and we've used the as bind group derive as well. Now we only have a single color here. It's not super important. So basically all this is doing for us is setting up the custom material WGSL fragment shader, which comes from our assets. And then of course we need to use the material plugin to actually be able to do that. So our shader here then is a regular fragment shader, but the mix that I was just talking about is right here. So we've got the color on the left-hand side and the color on the right-hand side. And depending on the normals, so the normal on the left here is a face that perfectly faces in the X direction, and the normal on the right is a face that perfectly faces in the Z direction, which means that on the left-hand side, the face has a normal of 1, 0, 0, and on the right, it's 0, 0, 1. So if we take those two numbers and we subtract them from each other, because they're always from 0 to 1, then we end up with a ratio that works for this positive area right here. Again, we don't really care about the negative values here, so it's fine. So what this does is it takes the ratio. So if like Z is 1 over here and X is 0, then what we end up getting is a ratio of 1. If X is 1 and Z is 0, then we end up getting a ratio of -1 or whatever. So what we end up with is a mix of these two colors across this rotation. And again, you could see this as the cube falls. And then, of course, we need the color for the top pane, the top face here, which is more of a white. So again, the normals are from 0 to 1. So if we test for world normal dot y being exactly equal to 1.0, which is usually a terrible idea to compare floats like this. But in our case, we know that this is going to be perfectly Y-shaped. So we can return this color instead of the mix for the other two. And then finally, we've got the tweening. So here's where we write our spawn cube command. And this, of course, is the same exact code that we just went over in main. The only difference is that we also define a couple of tweens here. The tween library, Bevy Tweening, is super interesting. We get to choose an ease function, the number of times that this tween is going to occur, the duration, and then what it's going to affect with the start and the end values. So for this first tween, this is handling the rotation. So it's transform rotation lens. The start is the default quaternion. I don't think we'll cover quaternions today. Basically, the default quaternion is the default rotation that you would have when you spawn it in, while the end position is a quaternion generated from a rotation around the y-axis, which is the vertical axis for us, using a fraction of pi over 2. So it's half of pi, or also known as 90 degrees. The second tween is almost the exact same thing. It's a tween that plays once with a bounce out animation. You can see this bouncing of 2 seconds. And in this case, we apply it to the position. So the transform.translation. We start at 0, 2, 0, which is above the camera. And we end at 0, 0, like we talked about before. So we set this whole thing up so that it would fall on 0, 0. And then we have this with completed event. And we use the tween events enum spawn new cube variant. And we turn that into a U64 before we send that when this tween ends. Our third tween is very similar. It's just taking it from 0 to -1 below the camera. And then we, when this is completed, fire off a despawn event. To use those tweens, we create a new animator component. And tracks is the way that we get parallelized tweens. So tweens that happen at the same time. In this case, they both have to be sequences because we're using an array here. So I'd make a single sequence from the original tween, the rotation. And then I take the positional tween, the one that is responsible for it to fall to 0, 0. And I chain that with a delay of 200 milliseconds before the third tween takes it out of frame. And this is really, 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 really nice. I'm super excited to have found this Bevy Tweening library. I will say that the one thing that I don't like about it is that sequence can't loop, which means that we do have to like respawn this cube in all the time. But that is an open issue on the repo, so that should come through soon. And the final really interesting thing about this is that when we do the tweening and we set this completed event only takes a U64. So we have to find a way to turn this spawn new cube variant or this tween events enum into a U64. In this case, we're using as to coerce it into a U64. And when we define the enum up here, we define the values that these enums are equal to, or these variants are equal to. In this case, spawn new cube is 0 and despawn self is 1. 0 and 1, you can imagine we could pass those in directly, but then we have to remember what those are in the other case, in main, in here, when we match on this user data. We would just have to know, right? And numbers are really hard to remember, for me anyway. So I chose to use as to coerce these to the values that they are, and then try from to bring it back. So try from is a trait that we can implement on tween events that might fail converting from whatever it is, in this case a U64, to the enum. In this case, we bring tween events, all of the variants into scope so that we don't need to keep writing tween events, :, whatever, whatever. And then we match on the value of the U64 that we're getting. In this case, 0 goes to spawn new cube, 1 goes to despawn self, and then underscore is an error. So this try from trait allows us to say, hey, you could take a U64 and potentially turn it into a tween events using this logic. So if we look back at the code that uses that, we do tween events try from the U64, and then we can match on that. And in the cases where it's successful, so we get a spawn new cube, it's very easy for us to figure out what we should be doing here. And that's it. That's the whole thing. I really like this effect. I really like the effect of sort of like geometry dropping in and then joining a larger piece of geometry. So I think I'll work with this a little bit more in the future. But yeah, the code, it'll be on GitHub. It'll be in the description. And I will see you in the next video.